thank the Calicut Gut Club for inviting me to give this talk on neuroendocrine tumor, which is becoming a very common problem in GI surgery and HPP surgery. So I will share. I will share my screen.
Yes, sir.
So pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor. So neuroendocrine tumors are epithelial neoplasms with predominant neuroendocrine differentiation, considered as a rare tumor traditionally, comprising of around 0.5% of all malignancies. But there is increasing incidence and prevalence, around 2.5 to 5 per 1 lakh people per year, and with increasing awareness and improvement in diagnostic modalities. So incidence of NET is increasing. So you can see the comparison of time frame between 1973 and 2003. You can see there is a rapid increasing size of neuroendocrine tumor, probably due to increasing imaging modality and better detection. So neuroendocrine cells distributed in GIT and pancreas. They include the alpha cells which secrete glucagon, beta cells which secrete insulin, delta secrete somatostatin. And there are so many other cells which secrete serotonin, histamine, gastrin, etc. I will come to the individual tumors later. So the distribution of NET varies in different parts of the world. This is an interesting observation I got from literature. In America, the US, the majority occur in foregut, whereas in Europe, majority occurs in midgut, and in Japan, majority occurs in the hindgut. That ductal carcinoids are more common type in Japan than the midgut carcinoid. So in gastrointestinal tract, 30% occur in ileum and 21% to 27% in rectum. And the popular belief was that appendix was the commonest site, but appendix is third after rectum. So pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor accounts for around 7% of all gastroenteropancreatic tumors and for up to 10% of all pancreatic neoplasms. But up to 25% of these tumors are associated with complex genetic syndromes. So sporadic tumors are seen in 75%, and 25% will have some genetic background compared to other type of tumors. So these are the hereditary syndromes associated with abdominal neuroendocrine tumors, including MEN1, MEN4, von Hippel-Lindau disease, tuberous sclerosis, and neurofibromatosis. So the individual components of these tumors, in MEN, they are gastrinoma, insulinoma, parathyroid tumors, and all. Whereas in von Hippel-Lindau, the neurofibroma, the tumors are usually benign type of lesions. They have higher incidence of pheochromocytoma, and the cause of mortality is usually renal cell carcinoma in von Hippel-Lindau disease. The other type of hereditary syndromes like tuberous sclerosis and neurofibromatosis 1, they have very less number of neuroendocrine tumors. But when you see somatostatinoma, the higher incidence will be in patients with von Recklinghausen's disease. So hereditary neuroendocrine tumors manifest about 15 years earlier than the age typical of sporadic tumors. In MEN1, pancreatic NETs account for 25 to 75%, majority of which are either non-functioning or gastrinomas. Neuroendocrine tumors in von Hippel-Lindau are typically benign, and generally they are multiple and non-functioning. In neurofibromatosis 1 and tuberous sclerosis, there is higher incidence of somatostatinoma, but these tumors are seen only in 1% of neurofibromatosis. Hello? And gastrinomas and insulinomas occur only in 1% of these hereditary syndromes. So when present, the somatostatinoma will be metastatic in around 30% of cases. So the classification of neuroendocrine tumor is based upon the grade of the tumor, mitotic activity, and Ka67 index. If the grade is G1, we'll say G1 and G2, they are all well differentiated, moderately differentiated, and G3, there is a tendency to call them as neuroendocrine carcinoma. So the 2010 WHO grading of neuroendocrine tumors depends upon three factors: one, the tumor grade, then the mitosis, and the Ka67 index. if the Ki-67 index is less than 2, less than 3%, and if the mitosis is less than 2, you call it as low-grade neuroendocrine tumor or grade 1. And if it is more than 20 and more than 20% Ki-67 index, you call it as high-grade. So the diagnosis depends upon the clinical presentation and tumor location. Symptoms due to hormone hypersecretion need estimation of specific hormone levels. There are tumor markers which are not specific for any tumor. There is a general tumor marker like chromogranin A. Then you need histopathologic analysis of the specimen, a demonstration of neuroendocrine markers like synaptophysin and chromogranin A in tissues. And when you see the poorly differentiated tumor, the expression of these neuroendocrine markers will be low. So if you have any particular markers identified, the chances of being a differentiated tumor is high. So this is the timeline of diagnostic modalities in neuroendocrine tumor. And by 2000, we have the newer method of the tumor markers as well as the newer PET imaging modalities. So the categories of circulating neuroendocrine biomarkers can be classified as type 0, which are indicators of natural history of the disease, type 1, which show the effects of an intervention in accordance with mechanism of action of a particular drug, and type 2 acts as a surrogate for clinical endpoints. So they classify this as multi-analytes and mono-analytes. Among the mono-analytes, you have the chromogranin A and individual hormones. So the biomarkers in neuroendocrine tumors are used for diagnosis, disease follow-up, identify therapeutic response, to define surgical effectiveness, to define aggressiveness of a remnant disease, to predict treatment relapse, and it has got prognostic importance. So the most important tumor marker used in neuroendocrine tumor is chromogranin A. It's elevated in around 90% of gut NET and correlate with tumor burden and recurrence. It's the best available biomarker. And highest values are seen in ileal NETs and gastrointestinal NET associated with MEN type 1. Both functioning and non-functioning tumors will secrete these chromogranin, will have elevated levels of chromogranin. And chromogranin is very more frequently elevated in well-differentiated tumors compared to poorly differentiated tumors. And if you treat a tumor effectively, there will be decrease in the level of chromogranin level. So it has got its own value in monitoring tumor therapeutic response. And measurement of chromogranin is mandatory for the effective diagnosis and management of neuroendocrine tumors. So chromogranin A has got a role in diagnosis, treatment response monitoring, and relapse detection. But there are so many conditions in which you can have elevated chromogranin A, which include the GA disorders and non-GA disorders, non-GA cancers, cardiovascular disease. So it's not a very specific thing for neuroendocrine tumor, but if you have a tumor and there is elevated chromogranin, you can suspect this tumor will be a neuroendocrine tumor. So the next thing is Ki-67. It is named after the city of origin. It's Kiel, Germany. It's a protein in cells that increases as they prepare to divide into new cells. So it's a marker of proliferation in tumor and present during all active phases of the cell cycle, including the G1 phase, S phase, and G2 phase, but it is absent in G0 phase. So the fraction of Ki-67 positive tumor cells is often correlated with the clinical course of the cancer. So there are morphologic and functioning imaging and invasive techniques used in pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, which include the transabdominal ultrasound, multi-detector CT, MR imaging, somatostatin receptor scintigraphy, FDG PET, and endoscopic ultrasound or endoscopy. So the imaging in pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, the transabdominal ultrasound has got a very limited sensitivity. But if you see a hypoechoic mass surrounded by a hyperechoic halo in pancreas, the chances of being a neuroendocrine tumor is high. Multi-detector CT will show the tumor as hypervascular lesion on arterial enhanced images. The MDCT is the most common initial imaging technique to evaluate suspected neuroendocrine tumor. It has got high spatial and temporal resolution, and it has got the capabilities to take thin collimated multiplanar reconstruction and image display in a desired plane. So it will have an improved lesion detection, and the present ray of multi-detector CT have got a higher lesion detection rate. So the lesion will be hypervascular in early arterial phase. MRI has got a superior intrinsic soft tissue contrast. It has got improved lesion detection and characterization, best used as a problem solving tool when you don't get a positive image on the other modalities. And it shows as a low signal lesion on T1 weighted image and hyper intense lesion on T2 weighted. And characteristics of MRI depends upon the cellular composition and tumor biology. Sometimes you can predict the type of tumor and grading by looking at the MRI image. On contrast MR, hypervascular lesions in the arterial phase, and they may show a varying degree of tumor heterogeneity. The next important thing in the diagnosis of neuroendocrine tumor is molecular image. So in molecular imaging, what we do is we will link a radionuclide with a peptide using a linker. So it's called the chelator. We use the DTPA in case of indium-111 DTPS octreotide spec CT. And in case of DOTA-TOC PET, the DOTA-TET or DOTA-NOC, etc. are the chelator. And the radionuclide is gallium-68. And the peptide is octreotide. So somatostatin analogs for SSR, somatostatin receptor PET scan, the gadolinium bound 68 DOTA-octreotide or the DOTA-TATE, they have a receptor sensitivity to somatostatin receptor type 2. This is very important because in patients with insulinoma, these type of the receptors are low. So the detection of the insulinoma by somatostatin receptor scintigraphy is in only 30%. So there are some normal areas in which you can have this uptake: the pituitary, salivary gland, thyroid, liver, spleen, kidney, bowel, adrenal, medulla, etc. But they all release the radioactive material early, and there won't be any persistent image. So the indications for use of the gadolinium PET CT in pancreatic and GI NET, it is to exclude more advanced disease prior to surgical intervention. So if you have extensive metastasis detected, we may not consider surgery as the primary mode of treatment. You can use it to localize the primary tumor in patients with biochemical suspicion of neuroendocrine tumor. And it can be used to identify primary tumor in patients with non-metastatic neuroendocrine tumor. Because in patients with the metastatic neuroendocrine tumor, the primary can be very small and the metastatic lesion can be very big. It is used to confirm diagnosis of neuroendocrine tumor in patients with anatomical lesions that are suspicious of neuroendocrine tumor. And you can identify patients who are likely to benefit from octreotide therapy or the PRRT using lutetium-177 or yttrium-90. The pitfalls of PET CT include, DOTA PET CT include, you have the physiologic uptake in pancreatic uncinate process, because the uncinate process has rich pancreatic polypeptide cells. So they take the DOTA-TOC, and in the splenoculi will also be seen as a hyper enhanced lesion. When there is a degenerative bone disease, when there are inflammatory lesions like reactive nodes or prostatitis, or in some brain tumors, even in benign brain tumors, you can have uptake. So when you have a well-differentiated tumor, there will be DOTA-TET uptake. When you have a poorly differentiated tumor, the uptake of DOTA will be less, but uptake of FDG PET will be more. So you may have to combine DOTA-TOC PET with PET CT, the FDG PET in selected cases. So the indications for selective use of FDG PET in with the somatostatin receptor, PET CT, include the Ki-67 of more than 5%. When you have worrisome lesions with little or no activity on the CT component of somatostatin receptor PET CT. So if you have no uptake on DOTATOC PET, that means you are having a poorly differentiated lesion there. So that may not be seen, and they are better seen on FDG PET. If you have a clinical or radiological progression within less than 6 months of surgical treatment or the other method of molecular treatment, and with a Ki-67 of less than 5%, you have to suspect or you have to indicate an FDG PET along with the somatostatin receptor PET. So in some cases, the tumor can have two areas. One area will be completely showing benign, especially the metastatic area may be showing aggressive nature. The primary may be showing benign nature. So the tumor heterogeneity can be identified using combination of somatostatin receptor PET as well as the FDG PET. So you can use FDG PET for the grading of the tumors as well. So if you have the FDG PET is negative, SSTR PET is positive, they are having either G1 or G2 tumor. But if the FDG PET is strongly positive and SSTR PET is positive only, you can consider them as a high-grade tumor. So in GPNET evaluation, when you suspect tumor clinically or when you suspect a tumor on an anatomical image, you have to look for the biochemical markers like serum chromogranin, 24-hour urine enterocytic acid estimation, etc. Then you go for functional image using the somatostatin receptor scintigraphy. That is in nutshell about the imaging diagnosis of neuroendocrine tumor. So coming to pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, you can have functioning tumors as well as non-functioning tumors. Around 70% are non-functioning and 30% are functioning tumors. Among the functioning tumor, insulinoma is the commonest, followed by gastrinoma, then followed by the VIPoma, and glucagonoma, somatostatinomas are not very common. So these are the functional neuroendocrine tumor. Of is the insulinoma, gastrinoma, glucagonoma, somatostatinoma, VIPoma, ACTH-OMA, etc. occur in pancreas. So when you see a patient with syndromes associated with hormonal excess, the principles of syndrome management include you have to reduce the hormone secretion or production by either surgery or other method. You can use some drugs to reduce the effects of secreted hormone, and you have to control the tumor growth, because when the tumor grows rapidly, patient can have problem. So therapy of neuroendocrine tumors, three principles: surgical therapy for either for cure, debulking treatment, or prevention of complications like bleeding. Symptomatic therapy for control of hormonal symptoms, and anti-proliferative therapy for control of tumor growth, and they may actually improve the survival. So the impact of surgical resection on survival, this is a review article published in Cancer. They have concluded that resection of primary tumor in patients with PNET is associated with improved survival across all disease stages, including the localized disease, regional and metastatic PNETs, who are reasonable operative candidates, should be considered for resection of their primary tumors. So the surgical principles in neuroendocrine tumor: offer surgical resection whenever possible, including even in cases of recurrent tumor. Prior to surgery, you have to treat the symptoms of hormone overproduction. You have to have adequate nutritional supplement to improve malnourished patients. Except for insulinoma and less than 2 cm gastrinoma, majority of PNETs require radical pancreatic resections with the lymph node dissection because of high likelihood of malignancy. And lesions located in the head and ancinate process usually treated by Whipple's resection, and lesions to the left of superior mesenteric vein portal vein treated by distal pancreatectomy. So coming to the individual neuroendocrine tumors, insulinoma is the most common functioning NET arising from beta cells of islets of Langerhans. It is evenly distributed throughout the gland. Even though we say the islets of Langerhans are the beta cells are more common in the body tail region. The tumors are evenly distributed and most commonly seen in females compared to males. Around 90% are benign, 90% are solitary, and 90% are less than 2 cm. 8 to 10% of insulinomas are associated with multiple endocrine neoplasia type 1, and the median age of diagnosis is 47 years. So the clinical presentation can be with neuroglucopenic symptom like headache, visual disturbances, confusion, personality changes, convulsions, coma, or it can present with cholinergic symptoms like hunger, sweating, or paresthesia, or they can present with adrenergic symptoms like anxiety, nervousness, tremors, tachycardia, and palpitation. Patient may come with weight gain, which is seen in around 20 to 30%. Most of these symptoms are worse in the morning hours, and these symptoms can be precipitated by exercise. So the diagnosis depends upon the demonstration of the Whipple's triad, that is hypoglycemic symptoms brought about by fasting or exercise, decreased blood sugar during symptoms, and relief on administration of glucose. So the diagnostic testing for insulinoma is a 72-hour supervised fast, which is a gold standard. When you fast this patient, the plasma glucose level will decrease to less than 2.5 millimole or the 45 milligram per deciliter. Plasma insulin level correspondingly will be more than 6 microunit per ml. Insulin to glucose ratio more than 0.4. Normal will be less than 0.3. Plasma C-peptide level will be more. Plasma pro-insulin level will be more than 0.5 nanomole per liter. The plasma sulfonylurea should be negative. Plasma beta-hydroxybutyrate should be less than 2.7 millimole per liter. And change in glucose with 1 milligram of glucagon should be more than or equal to 25 milligram per deciliter at 30 minutes. So these are the diagnostic criteria using 72 hours fast. So the symptoms will develop in 35% of patients within 12 hours, 75% of patients within 24 hours, 92% within 48 hours, and 99% within 72 hours. So 1% cannot be diagnosed by using this fasting test. You can use other tests like C-peptide suppression test or stimulation test with glucagon, calcium, or tolbutamide. So the differential diagnosis will include nasidioblastosis, which is seen in some patients with chronic pancreatitis or some other conditions when there is extensive hyperplasia of islets of Langerhans, beta cells of islets, or it can be due to factitious hypoglycemia induced by excessive use of oral hypoglycemic agents. So important issue in the management of insulinoma is its localization, because majority of these tumors are less than 2 cm, which are not detected when they are less than 1 cm by standard imaging technique. So the transabdominal ultrasound has got a very low value. The triple phase CT may detect when the lesion is 2 cm or more. MRI with contrast may be helpful. Endoscopic ultrasound you can use to locate the lesion, especially in the head of pancreas. But you may use somatostatin receptor scintigraphy, but only in 30% it will be successful. You may have to use intraoperative ultrasound. That is the most common method we can use for intraoperative detection using ultrasound. So if you have a doubt, the lesion is either the head or body tail region, you can use selective intra-arterial calcium stimulation. So what you do is you keep catheters first in the gastroduodenal artery, then you stimulate the head of pancreas by calcium, then check the hepatic venous sample for the levels of insulin. Then you keep the catheter in the splenic artery, then you stimulate the body tail region, and then you collect the hepatic venous sample and look the level of insulin. So you can diagnose which part of pancreas the tumor is actually placed. When you have multiple tumors, it may not work. So the management, you can use the medical treatment when the patient is awaiting surgery or when the patient is having metastatic disease which cannot be treated by surgical method, or when there is surgery is already failed. The options include dietary adjustments, frequent feeds, diazoxide with use of hydrochlorothiazide, You can use calcium channel blockers like verapamil and nifedipine to control the symptoms. You can use somatostatin analogs, but you can have paradoxical effect in around 30% of patients. Chemotherapy may be effective in very aggressive tumors using streptozotocin or doxorubicin. If there are multiple meds, you can consider hepatic artery embolization to decrease the level of insulin. The surgical removal is the only curative treatment in insulinoma. Majority of these lesions are treated by enucleation because majority are benign lesions. But if there is communication or close contact with the ductal system, the enucleation can result in pancreatic leakage and fistulas. So you have to have a good imaging of the pancreatic duct and its relation with the tumor, because after you do a laparoscopic or even open enucleation, there may be ductal disruption and leakage. So when the tumor is more than 2 to 5 centimeters in the body tail region, you may have to do a distal pancreatectomy. When the tumor is less, you can do an enucleation. When even in larger tumors, like 2 to 5 centimeter lesion in head of the pancreas can be enucleated. But if the lesion size increases, the chances of becoming being a malignant lesion is very high. So you have to combine the lymph node dissections along with the radical resections of a neuroendocrine tumor. When the tumor is in the head of pancreas, we have to do Whipple's procedure. When the tumor in the body tail region, we will try to do a spleen preserving distal pancreatectomy. So this is one patient. Actually, this patient came with a very interesting story. He was a diabetic patient, and suddenly he became a non-diabetic and he started gaining weight. So patient was evaluated and identified to have a lesion in the body tail region of the pancreas, imagined on CT because the lesion is more than 2 centimeters. So we did a distal pancreatectomy, spleen preserving. And the lymph nodes also showed the tumor. So there you can see the specimen with the lymph nodes adjacent to that. So when you do surgery on insulinoma, the anesthesia considerations are, when it is associated with MEN1, you have to treat the parathyroid tumor first. You have to hydrate the patient thoroughly before surgery. You have to have good preoperative sugar management. This patient after enucleation will have very high sugar values, that is called the hyperglycemic rebound. And post enucleation or post resection, sugar management is also very important in insulinomas. So next tumor is gastrinoma. Most of them present with abdominal pain or peptic ulceration of proximal GIT or diarrhea. One should suspect gastrinoma in patients with recurrent postoperative ulcers, ulcers associated with diarrhea, or with the family history of ulcers or multiple endocrine neoplasia, and failure to respond to adequate medical therapy. Around 75% of gastrinomas occur sporadically, and 60% of gastrinomas are malignant and present with local invasion and metastasis. They are typically found in duodenum, around 49%. Around 24% are found in pancreatic head, and 11% of lesions may be seen in the peripancreatic lymph nodes. So that is very interesting. So gastrinoma usually occur in a triangle described by Passaro et al. It's called the Passaro's triangle. It's a triangle bounded by three lines going through three imaginary plane. One is the cystic duct bile duct junction, the other point being the neck of pancreas, and the third portion of duodenum. So the diagnosis depends upon the level of fasting gastrin, which is more than 200 picograms per ml, then the paradoxical elevation of gastrin by secretin stimulation. When the normal individual, when secretin is stimulated, actually the gastrin level decreases, whereas in gastrinoma, the level increases. You can use radiologic studies to localize the lesions, including EUS, but EUS has got a lesser sensitivity for detection of gastrinoma. One can use radio labeled scanning using this DotaTOC PET for identification of this lesion. The treatment, preoperatively, patient should be treated with high dose proton pump inhibitors. Whipple's procedure is usually recommended for larger lesions or clinically malignant tumors in the head of pancreas, because majority of the lesion occur in the head.
That's true, na?
All enlarged peripancreatic and periduodenal lymph nodes should be removed. The single hepatic metastasis may be resected along with the primary lesion. If there are multiple metastases, it may not be resectable. Octreotide can be used to decrease gastrin secretion. Hepatic arterial embolization of liver metastasis may provide good palliation. In desperate situation, when there are multiple liver met, the lesion will produce multiple gastrin, very high gastrin. The patient will have multiple ulcers. We can consider palliative total gastrectomy because that is the site of production of ulcer, the acid. Even though the gastrin will be produced from anywhere, it will finally act on the ulcer producing, the acid producing cells of the stomach. The glaucoma usually arises from the alpha cells of islets of Langerhans. Patient will present with mild diabetes mellitus, stomatitis, anemia, or malnutrition. The necrolytic migratory erythema, it's a classical of glaucoma syndrome, but seen in only 5% to 8% of patients. The classical presentation and biopsy of this necrolytic migratory erythema is sufficient for diagnosis of glaucoma. The tumors are usually larger sized and it is easily detectable by the MDCT imaging. The hyperglycemia, hypoproteinemia, and elevated fasting glucagon level of more than 150 picogram per ml confirms the diagnosis of glaucoma. So the treatment, patients needs preoperative octreotide, hyperalimentation, and DVT prophylaxis. If you start octreotide, the skin lesions in necrolytic migratory erythema will rapidly fade. So up to 70% of patients, the tumor present with metastasis, and surgery is the only potentially curative treatment. Most tumors are solitary and located in the tail, where they are amenable for distal pancreatectomy with or without splenectomy. Palliative debulking in the setting of metastatic disease may help refractory symptoms. Octreotide and embolization of hepatic artery metastasis may help control the symptoms.
Sir, now general surgery.
So this is one patient in whom we did a distal pancreatectomy, splenectomy for a large glaucoma with symptoms. This patient recurred after 4 years with a lesion in this the left renal hilum. We had to do a nephrectomy. After that, the patient developed metastasis around 4 years later, and now the patient is on somatostatin receptor therapy. So VIPoma, the classical description is the WDHA or the watery diarrhea, hypokalemia, chlorhydria syndrome, or the pancreatic cholera. Usually presents with large volume diarrhea, muscular weakness due to hypokalemia, hyperglycemia, hypercalcemia, and rarely they may present with flushings like a carcinoid tumor. You have to exclude other causes for diarrhea in patients with VIPoma. So VIP secretion is episodic. So you need to obtain multiple morning samples of or fasting samples of VIP to diagnose VIPoma. So the treatment, you have to replenish the fluid and electrolyte loss. Diarrhea may be treated by octreotide. Since the lesion is located mostly in the body tail region, you can treat by distal pancreatectomy. This lesion is smaller, less than 2 centimeters, one can try enucleation. If the tumor is not localized, the autonomic chain and adrenal should be examined for extra pancreatic tumors. If no tumor is identified, distal pancreatectomy may be considered because the lesion is most commonly located to the left of portal vein, superior mesenteric vein confluence. The palliative debulking may be performed for metastatic disease because of this electrolyte imbalance which they produce. Octreotide and hepatic artery embolization may provide palliation of symptoms. The somatostatinomas usually arise from the delta cells of islets of Langerhans. Most common location is either duodenum or head of pancreas. There are increased incidence in patients with neurofibromatosis 1. I have operated around 6 cases of somatostatinoma, of which 5 were in patients with neurofibromatosis. So they may present with symptom exteaturia, diabetes, hypochloridria, and gallstones. They are mostly malignant, and majority will present with metastasis to the liver at the time of first detection. The diagnosis by fasting somatostatin level of more than 100 picogram per ml. These tumors, when you examine histologically or EUS, you will show the characteristic Popoon calcification which you see in patients with papillary CFO. So usually treated by pancreatoduodenectomy because they occur in the head of pancreas. You have to replenish the fluid and electrolyte balance before surgery. So this is one patient. Actually, this patient presented with severe pancreatitis because the tumor was in the ampullary region. So the gastroenterologist did pancreatic duct stenting first. Since the pancreatitis was not improving, we considered a resection for this patient. We did a Whipple's resection, and this patient survived for 6 years and died of intracranial tumor later. The non-functioning tumors account for 70% of neuroendocrine tumors. They have no defined clinical syndrome, but when they develop metastasis, they may present with either of these syndrome or the features of carcinoid syndrome. These tumors usually present with abdominal pain, weight loss, and jaundice when they occur in the head of pancreas, like adenocarcinomas, most commonly found in head, neck, and uncinate process of pancreas. And tumors are localized and staged by functioning tumors of neuropancreatic endocrine system. So this is one lead tumor. When this patient underwent ultrasound for vague abdominal pain, somebody detected dilatation of pancreatic duct. So they suspected either IPMN or the early stage of chronic pancreatitis. So they did a CT which showed dilatation limited to the body tail region with abrupt cut with a solid enhancing lesion in the body of pancreas. They did MRA which demonstrated the pancreatic duct dilatation without intraductal enhancing lesion but abrupt cut off by an enhancing tumor at the body of pancreas. We resected this patient, and finally this report came as grade 2 neuroendocrine tumor of pancreas. We did a distal pancreatectomy splenectomy because this was densely adherent to the splenic vein. So this next part will be on metastatic neuroendocrine tumor. In fact, the liver and bone represents the most common site for metastasis in neuroendocrine tumors. So this is one unfortunate girl presented with back pain, evaluated, identified multiple vertebral collapse. When we examined, this patient was having skull lesions, multiple punched out lesions in the skull. The CT showed a large lesion in the body tail region. We resected this patient, but the grade of this tumor was high grade, and this girl succumbed. So when you have metastatic neuroendocrine tumor, you try to do an R0 resection and then follow up. If the tumor is not resectable, if the patient has got a grade 1 and 2 grade 2 tumor or well-differentiated tumor, you can have this molecular targeted therapy. If the patient has got high-grade tumor, one has to consider chemotherapy. There are three patterns of liver metastasis in neuroendocrine tumor. Type 1 is a restricted type of metastasis confined to one liver lobe or adjacent one or two segments. It's seen in around 20 to 24% of cases. They are all resectable lesions. Or type 2, when you have a dominant lesion with bilobar metastasis, you may consider resection in some cases. But type 3, they have diffuse multifocal liver metastasis. That is the most common presentation you've seen in around 60 to 70%. So this majority of these liver metastasis may not be completely resectable, but one can consider palliative resection because debulking of functioning metastasis can actually improve the quality of life. So the treatment of metastatic neuroendocrine tumor, either you can observe the patient or you can give the somatostatin analogs, can consider surgery, and you can have the molecular targeted therapy. Observation is considered only in very selected patient with low volume, asymptomatic, non-functional metastatic disease. observation is with an expectant management. At any time, you can intervene this patient when they develop symptoms. You have to do the follow-up with the serial diagnostic imaging. So the next option is the targeted therapy using the somatostatin analogs. There are two, now there are three long-acting analogs. One is the octreotide LAR, the other is lanreotide, and the newer one is pasireotide. They were initially used in patients with secretory symptoms. And in some of these patients, they found that there is progression-free survival. So they were used for the preventing the proliferation of these lesions. So there were these are the possible mechanism of anti-proliferative activity of somatostatin analogs. They may bind to this receptor and it has got direct anti-proliferative effect. They can have systemic effect as well. So they will inhibit the growth of these tumor cells. There are two RCTs. This one is the PROMIT trial, which used the octreotide LAR. And this patient, they finally showed octreotide LAR group was associated with improved time to progression of this neuroendocrine metastasis. The second one was the, this is the original study, the phase 3 study of octreotide LAR. They actually randomized patients into the two group, one with the placebo, other is the octreotide 30 milligram per 28 days. The endpoint, the second primary endpoint was medium type to tumor progression, and secondary endpoints were objective tumor response rate, symptom control, and overall survival. So the second trial was the CLARINET trial. They used the lanreotide, and both these trials actually found there is a significant improved progression-free survival. So this was the original trial published in New England Journal. So the somatostatin analogs produce a reduction in tumor size in 10% cases, stabilization of tumor in majority, biochemical response in 50 to 70%, and symptomatic response in 70 to 90%. So they are having adverse effects. There is increased risk of cholelithiasis. Some articles actually recommend prophylactic cholecystectomy before you plan this treatment. So it just got benefits and limitations. So the limitations include when there is high tumor burden, it may not be very effective. There is a tachyphylaxis when you use this agent for a long time. When you use it for insulinoma, patient can have paradoxical effect. Patient can have worsening of coronary artery disease, the moderate decrease in tumor markers. And there is no value in somatostatin receptor negative neuroendocrine tumors. So there is an entity called somatostatin analog resistant tumor. Is due to tachyphylaxis, either by down regulation or internalization of the somatostatin receptors, or the upregulation of other subtypes of somatostatin receptor, or variable phosphorylation or heterodimerization. So these patients will not respond for a longer time. So second will be surgery. There are many trials and the randomized, non-randomized trial, the meta-analysis of surgical series. Majority of these trials have found that when patient has got a liver metastasis and when you do resection, the patient has got a 60% to 80% 5-year survival following complete resection of liver metastasis. Even with a positive margin, they have better survival. But if the liver metastasis is left untreated, only 30 to 40% will have 5-year survival. So this is the meta-analysis of systematic review and meta-analysis of articles published. Finally, they have found that cytoreductive surgery has got a definite role in reducing hormone secretion and improving survival. So the next group of agents is molecularly targeted therapies like mTOR inhibitor, the everolimus. They act by inhibiting cell proliferation, angiogenesis, and cell metabolism, and they have proven progression-free survival in randomized controlled trials. The next agent is the multi-targeted kinase inhibitor, sunitinib, which inhibits the angiogenesis of tumors. So this is the classical Radiant published. The Radiant 2 actually used a combination of everolimus plus octreotide versus octreotide plus placebo. But later they used everolimus alone in Radiant 3 and Radiant 4 trial, and majority of these patients, they found that there is significant reduction in the risk of progression of death in patients who are using everolimus. So it has got some side effects, including stomatitis, diarrhea, hypophosphatemia, hyperglycemia, pneumonitis, etc. So the next agent is sunitinib. This is the trial published, the role of sunitinib in pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors. Compared to placebo, sunitinib has got an increased progression-free survival and overall survival. So this is the trial on sunitinib versus placebo in patients with the pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor. They are randomized into sunitinib 37.5 milligram per day versus placebo. And finally, they have found that there is improved progression-free survival in patients with sunitinib. It is actually 11.4 months for sunitinib up, and it is 5.5 months for placebo. So the side effects include diarrhea, nausea, vomiting, change in hair color, palmar-plantar erythrodysesthesia, otherwise called hand-foot syndrome and hypothyroidism. There are some newcomers in the armamentarium like pasopanib and a depo octreotide in advanced. This is an article published on the role of the newer agent. They have found found to be having promise in treating patients with neuroendocrine tumor mets. So, and the other agent is interferon alpha. It has got direct anti-proliferative effect, and it actually inhibits tumor angiogenesis. It has shown 50% improvement in biochemical response, and the median duration of response for around 20 months. So the tumor response occurs only in 10 to 15% patients, but tumor stabilization is reported in around 40 to 60%. So the next option will be the use of radiolabeled SST analogs in the treatment. They use either yttrium 90, DOTA octreotide, or intium 111 pentriotide, or lutetium 177 DOTA. So it's called the peptide receptor radionuclide therapy. So they attach this to the somatostatin analog that will deliver local cytotoxic radiation to the neuroendocrine tumor. You have to administer it intravenously every 8 weeks. Around 4 doses is given. So this is a NETTER-1 trial which actually compared placebo with the use of BRRT, and which showed a progression-free survival in patients who are having somatostatin receptor positivity using this BRRT. So the objective response rate is seen in around 30 to 40%. Survival benefit is likely because when they respond to the therapy, they will actually will have better survival. The chemotherapy, there is no high quality RCTs. The majority of these are actually extrapolated from small cell carcinoma treatment, and they use platinum-based chemotherapy or streptozotocin or doxorubicin, but they have a very poor response, and the overall response is not very good for chemotherapy. So there are some unanswered questions. What is the best predictive and prognostic marker for neuroendocrine tumor? What is the optimal follow-up strategy for neuroendocrine tumor? We have seen patients developing liver metastasis even after 15 years of primary surgery in pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor. So it's not defined. And how to sequence the campaign the newer therapeutic options? Which one to be taken first, whether you do give somatostatin analogs or whether you give everolimus or other multi-targeted kinase inhibitors. And you have to have these effects of newer treatment modalities on quality of life and survivorship. So the strategy for better survival, early biochemical diagnosis followed by anatomical delineation of neuroendocrine tumor, early surgical and pharmacotherapeutic interventions. And to summarize, neuroendocrine tumors are a heterogeneous group of neoplasm arising from diffuse neuroendocrine system, accounting for 1.5% of all GA and pancreatic tumors. All neuroendocrine tumors are potentially malignant. That is the basis of treating these tumors, because you have to consider all are malignant, and you have to expect metastasis even in a very low-grade tumors. But their biological characteristics differ based upon their type of origin and cellularity. The diagnosis based on clinical manifestation, laboratory parameters, imaging, and tissue biomarkers in biopsy specimen. Complete surgical resection remains the only potentially curative treatment, and medical treatment is offered to control disease and symptom related to hormone hypersecretion. I think that will be the last slide. Thank you.
Thank you, Pradhaban. Excellent talk. It's a vast topic and you have covered it comprehensively itself. Thank you. To start the discussion, I will just start off with one or two doubts I have, myself have in mind. I'm audible now, Pradhaban?
Yes, yes, you are audible.
Yeah. Okay. So one thing, what is the usual investigation set that we order when we diagnose a neuroendocrine tumor? If it is a functional and if it is a non-functional. We have just diagnosed that it is a neuroendocrine tumor, either by US guided biopsy or due to functional symptoms. We have diagnosed that there is a neuroendocrine pancreatic tumor. So what is the next step? How we will be investigating?
No, the issue is if you have imaged a lesion in pancreas and if you want to identify whether it is a neuroendocrine tumor or adenocarcinoma, it is very easy. If this patient is having a syndrome and it is not identified on your imaging, then comes the serial imaging modalities. So if the patient is presenting with the syndrome, that means there is hormone hypersecretion, then you have to go for the level of this hormone. When you have insulinoma, you have to go, I have already mentioned. Then you have to go for the localization studies. When the tumor is larger size, you can order an MDC, multi-detector CT. That is the first thing we order for any tumor in the pancreas. And majority of tumors more than 2 centimeters will be picked up. But if you have a suspicion of metastatic disease, then you have to go for either the CT scan or the functional imaging, because when you have a well-differentiated tumors with metastasis, the DOTA PET scan will pick up these lesions earlier. But if the tumor is of high grade, the DOTA will not pick up the metastasis. You have to order a FDG PET. So the chances of the metastatic lesions are very high in neuroendocrine tumor. Then even in a smaller lesion, one has to do a metastatic workup along with the workup for the primary. So if there is hormone secreting lesion, go for the biochemical analysis of this tumor, like glucagon is not easily available, but insulin we can set, estimate, or proinsulin, etc., are easily available. Then you go for an imaging, either a CT. If the CT shows an equivocal imaging, we can consider neuroendocrine, the MRI with contrast, because MRI has got a better tissue characterization. Endoscopic ultrasound, when you have a lesion in the head of pancreas, uncinate process, etc., the detection is higher. But the lesion is in the body tail region, it is very difficult to keep the scope in that position and take biopsy or image. So for detecting lesion in the tail region, I think the US is having some limitation. Then once you have diagnosed, then you will order subsequent investigations like CT-guided FNA or US-guided FNA, look for the grading, and then plan accordingly. Okay.
So is a DOTA PET required when you diagnose a non-functional neuroendocrine tumor?
If you have metastatic disease, or if you suspect metastatic, because in non-functioning tumor, I have experienced non-functioning tumor, when they develop metastasis, they may develop carcinoid syndrome or syndrome overproduction. But if you have only a primary lesion in the pancreas, and the initial imaging does not show any evidence of metastasis, and if your chromogranin level is not very high, you need not go for DOTA top PET. But if you have a smaller lesion in the pancreas the CT shows some lesions elsewhere, or in the, either in one lobe or multiple lesions, it can be metastasis or it can be some other lesions. But on a background of neuroendocrine tumor, if you have metastatic lesion, you have to order a dot-o-toc PET, even in non-functioning tumors. But the grade of tumor and the receptor positivity are the two things which give you a positive report. And there are some patients in which you may see some lesions, but they may not be actual lesions, especially when you have a splenectomy located in pancreas, or when you have some other lesion in the uncinate process detectors, may not be actual primary lesions. So I think it has got a role when you have the metastasis suspected, or larger lesions in the pancreatic head, or when you have non-characterized lesion on CT or MRI in liver and all.
Okay. There is one question in the chat box, Padavan.
Yes.
Should we do, by Subhagar Saha, should we do 24 hours urine HIA and serum chromogranin A, both preoperative evaluation, or only serum chromogranin is enough?
Yeah. I think these two are non-specific markers, which will not tell you actually what is happening. But chromogranin is more sensitive, and it has got a better predictive value for a neuroendocrine lesion. Whereas the 5-hydroxyintolacetic acid is increased in carcinoid tumor, because that happens when the tryptophan metabolism, tryptophan to niacin is affected, it will be converted to 5-hydroxytryptamine. And they are seen in patients with atypical carcinoid syndrome or in forbid carcinoid. They are not actually seen in patients with pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors. No, even non-functioning tumors will not produce high levels of 5-hydroxyintolacetic acid and all. But chromogranin level can be produced, because they can secrete chromogranin. Because when you stain this tumor, they will actually show the chromogranin and synaptophysin. That means when the tumor is of differentiated type, they will produce chromogranin even in non-functioning lesions. So the level of chromogranin has nothing to do with the functionality of this tumor. But carcinoid tumor, the 5-hydroxyintolacetic acid actually indicate the syndrome development, because only when there is excess production of serotonin and all, this patient will have carcinoid syndrome. So when you suspect carcinoid tumor, you have to do both. But when you have pancreatic neuroendocrine non-functioning, I don't think there is a role for 5-HA unless there is evidence of carcinoid syndrome.
So one more question from Shine is there. Why not he unmute and ask the question by himself? Shine, are you there?
Hey, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Ask the question.
Sir, we have one patient, actually. He is a newly detected Menman syndrome, because he has hyperparathyroidism, prolactinoma, as well as when we did the OGD, there are multiple lesions in the fundus as well as body. And with the biopsy showing neuroendocrine tumor.
Hmm.
And in the ultrasound, we have done one CT also. It's showing one 8-centimeter lesion in the head of pancreas.
Hmm. So you treat the 8-centimeter lesion in the pancreas. I will tell you, there are the lesion in the stomach is actually microcarcinoid or the carcinoid tumor arising in stomach secondary to Solinger-Ellison syndrome or the hypersecretion. So they are all secondary events, secondary to the actual pancreatic tumor. I think you have to treat the parathyroid problem first by surgery. Then you consider surgery of the head of pancreas lesion. I think most of these lesions will decrease in size, because it's, carcinoid tumor of stomach, there are three types. One, the atrophic gastritis associated. Second is Solinger-Ellison associated. I think this group belongs to the Solinger-Ellison. So stomach lesion has not much significance, but pancreatic lesion is significant.
But sir, the size of the lesion, actually all the lesions are more than 2 centimeters in the stomach. So should we go with the gastrectomy also?
That's no. I don't think. You just treat the parathyroid syndrome, then you try to do pancreatic resection. Wait, because these gastric lesions may sometimes atrophy or sometimes it may disappear.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Any other questions from the audience? Anybody want to raise a question, please? So Pradhaman, you mentioned that there is no general protocol for follow-up, but how do you follow up these patients, especially the
these patients? Metastasis. Non-functioning or function? Non-functioning. Non-functioning tumors which we resected, we will look for the grade of the lesion. If they have a well-differentiated tumor, we will ask them to follow up every 6 months to 1 year time. If they have a high-grade tumor, we will get an oncology opinion regarding the use of somatostatin analogs. Even in non-functioning tumors, the somatostatin analogs may be considered when they have lower grade, but they have a large volume disease. So when the size of the lesion is more, the chances of metastasis occult or either later manifesting is high. I think they have a role in the SSRI, somatostatin receptor analogs has got a role. But we follow up this patient every 6 months with a routine ultrasound imaging. And if there is any syndrome or other thing, we will do the other estimations. So far, I have two patients with carcinoid syndrome on treatment. But I did Whipple's resection in 2010. Patient was having metastasis at that time also. Then I did a liver resection. After the liver resection, patient started developing carcinoid syndrome. Up to that time, there was nothing. So this patient is on follow-up with a somatostatin receptor treatment. She is continuing. So there is no time limit for continuing this sort of therapy, because the SSRI receptor analogs, if you stop, this patient will develop symptoms. So they will not actually decrease the tumor size. They will actually stabilize the tumor. There are no clear the anti-tumor substance described or indicated. Even sunitinib, they will have a stabilizing role. They won't have a role in killing tumor cells. So I think you have to follow up all these patients. I have seen a glaucoma patient developing hyperglycemia 15 years after primary resection. When I imagined that patient was having a lesion in the segment 6, I did a liver resection and that was showing glaucoma. She got rid of her symptoms. We know she may develop a recurrent disease or metastasis in other lobe later. So we have to follow up all these patients. But even if you miss the follow up, because these tumors are not very aggressive, you can opt some treatment after 6 months or 1 year. That is the importance of neuroendocrine tumor. If it is an adenocarcinoma, you lost that patient at that moment.
Any other questions? Anybody? So one more thing, Pradhan, any role for conservative treatment? I mean, you have detected a very small lesion.
Yes. So there are many studies which looked into this observation pattern. When the lesion is less than 2 cm, they are non-functioning without worrisome features. If there is no signs of the compression on the pancreatic duct, compression on the bile duct, or there is no functioning tumor, you can actually observe lesions less than 2 cm in size. So when there is ductal dilatation, or when there is development of the lymph nodes on imaging, or when there is development of symptoms of these tumors, when there is pain or other thing related to this tumor, you have to do surgery. So asymptomatic small NET without hormone production, without any compression, one can safely follow up patients, especially when the lesion is in the body tail region. when the lesion is in the head of pancreas, that decision is very crucial. Sometimes the lesion can increase in size and your Whipple's section, which was very easy to begin with, may become very difficult. So in some patients, the decision is very, very risky or very crucial. So you can actually weigh the risk and benefits of surgery. If the lesion is in the body tail region, the surgery is easier and you can try resection in patients. But if the lesion is in the head of pancreas, your surgery is going to be a very major one. In such situation, when the lesion is smaller, non-functioning, when there are no obstruction, I think you can safely observe. Less than 2 cm, smaller tumors. So the control trials on observing versus resection in literature, and they found in low grade tumors, when the lesion is of G1 grade, K67 on FNA, you have to do a grading study. If the tumor is of low grade, if the tumor is of well differentiated type, or if the tumor is not having a low Ki-67 index, you can safely follow these patients. But if your grade is more, if there is a Ki-67 index is more, if there is symptom, you have to consider surgical resection.
Any other questions? So could I ask one more, Pradham?
Yes.
So anything to select the patient for PRRT, other than they have got somatostatin receptor activity is there, but still it is present all over. You have already mentioned it is present in other organs also, this somatostatin receptor. So which patient will be benefiting PRRT?
No, the issue is when you do somatostatin receptor scintigraphy, and if the metastatic lesions picked up this DOTA-TOC, that means these lesions are amenable for PRRT, because you are binding the lutetium 177 to octreotide. So this will bind there. But if that is not imaged, that means if you give somatostatin receptor bound lutetium in a patient who is having somatostatin receptor negative lesion, they may not respond. The volume of lesion is also important. If you have a very large volume liver lesion, if you have bilobar lesions, you cannot give that much load of lutetium 177, and the part of the liver you cannot actually treat. So the volume of metastasis has something to do with PRRT therapy. We cannot give too much dose to all patients. So we may combine resection with PRRT, or we may have to combine somatostatin receptor therapy, stabilize for some time, then you can consider, then you resect, or then you can have radio, the RF ablation of larger lesion. So you have to use multiple treatment modalities when the tumors are very large, or when the volume of tumor is very high. But PRRT will work only in well-differentiated tumors, because only well-differentiated or moderately differentiated tumor will have these receptors, and they only accept the radio-labeled octreotide. So it's not possible to treat a poorly differentiated metastatic disease with the PRRT. Second issue, the poorly differentiated tumors, them will not produce syndromes most often. They will actually behave like an adenocarcinoma, aggressive adenocarcinoma like lesions.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, yes.
Sir, we had a insulinoma patient. We had the patient referred from endocrinology. They had done extensive evaluation. They had done Xendin for PET CT, that is usually done for insulinoma when you have where you have GLP-1 as the target. So once Xendin for PET was done, and it was showing uptake in the head as well as sort of a diffuse sort of a uptake in the tail region also. So suggestive of a multicentric sort of a.
It can either be multicentric insulinoma, or it can very well be an esophageoblastosis this type of
So we went ahead during surgery. No. We did a Whipple, and in-robe ultrasound did not show any lesion in the tail, but because there was a significant XN4 uptake, they had reported as a definitive lesion. So we also did a distal. It was very close to the tail, so we had done a distal pancreatectomy also. So then finally the HBR came as insulinoma in the head and nesidioblastosis in the tail.
So that is a very, that's a nesidioblastosis is a very tricky situation. So if you don't identify a single lesion or isolated lesion and you do a distal pancreatectomy, this patient can have symptom relief for some time. But nesidioblastosis usually occurs secondary to some stimulants, because something is stimulating the growth of neuroendocrine, the islets of Langerhans. So we don't identify these things, and you do a blind lift, the resection, they have a symptomatic relief for some time, and after that they will have problem in the head region. If there is no definite lesions, doing blind distal pancreatectomy, thinking that the insulinoma occurs majority in the tail, it's not correct. So nesidioblastosis is a very tricky situation. I had a patient, he actually extensively worked up for neuroendocrine, the insulinoma. They could not find out anything. So finally, I suggested surgery. So he was willing. I did distal pancreatectomy. Only very small rim of pancreas I left. But after 2 years, he again developed symptoms of the insulinoma, insulin production, or insulin production. Now he is on diazoxide for the last so many years. So that is the problem. So nesidioblastosis cannot be treated unless you do a total pancreatectomy. If you do a total pancreatectomy, you are safe because you are removing the entire pancreas.
Even with so much resection, patient was having a very bad diabetes. Had to be, most of sugars were very difficult to control. So total pancreatectomy is going
to
be
easier to control, because when you do total pancreatectomy, the dose of insulin is fixed. There is no glucagon, there is no other hyperglycemic hormone. So a fixed dose of insulin may work in most of these patients, unless there is pain or some other lesions to increase adrenaline. So if there is low adrenergic output, and if you have done a total pancreatectomy, it is easier to manage by insulin, long-acting insulin. You may have to give long-term pancreatic enzyme therapy. Otherwise, they may develop malnutrition, especially the protein energy malnutrition they may develop.
Yes.
Okay.
So you want to ask anything about the intraoperative, for insulinoma enucleation, intraoperative tricks to the young surgeons? Initially, it was to do a proper.
I have experience of two patients. One patient, they identified a lesion on CT and found there is a lesion in the tail region. And I extensively palpated for that lesion. I could not find out. Then I was about to close the abdomen. Just I rubbed my finger over the head of pancreas. I could identify a small pinhead-like lesion. So I enucleated that. That patient is completely symptom-free now. Sometimes you are the sensitive fingers are better than most of this, your ultrasounds. Because if you regularly palpate an organ, you may find the difference. But if you are planning a laparoscopic enucleation, I think laparoscopic ultrasound is a must. You have to look for the ductal relations and the localization of lesion. If you are having an open technique, when the lesion is more towards the posterior aspect of pancreas, which may not be easily palpable unless you completely expose or completely mobilize the splenopancreatic area, then you have to use this intraoperative ultrasound. I think intraoperative ultrasound, when used, has got around more than 95% pickup rate when the lesion, even in smaller lesion, less than 1 cm. But it has to be done by an expert person who is regularly doing intraoperative ultrasound, not for an occasional user. Because these insulinomas are operated very occasionally, at least one case a year and all. And if you try to identify by your own, it is not possible. So in a high volume center, when they do routine surgeries for neuroendocrine tumor, you can recommend intraoperative ultrasound. But if you are an occasional surgeon doing it, I don't think it may not pick up that easily.